So today we ask the all-important question, are we going to the moon? Last time I gave you a very brief tour of this awesome tool to show you some of the stuff that's inside. But those of you casting a keen eye may have noticed that something isn't in this model. It doesn't contain token price forecasts or fair value estimates for our tokens. The first reason why this might strike you as strange is because these are very interesting things to know. In an investment context, above all, they are probably the most interesting. If any of you have worked with financial models that are built to guide investment decisions, you'll know that calculating valuations are among the most important things that those models do. But we are building this model to support an investment case and decision. And yet here I am telling you that we're leaving these kind of value calculations out of the model. So what's going on? Well, valuation is about more than just memorizing clever formulas and chucking data at them. You have to be able to critically assess the valuation methods that are on offer. First, to judge if they provide appropriate framing for the business that you're analyzing and the decision you want to make. And then second, to judge whether the data that's available to go into the value calculation will allow you to make meaningful or reliable judgments with it. All that goes hand in hand with understanding the difference between the concerns of mathematical theory versus real-life decision-making. If there aren't any metrics that meet our practical needs and criteria, you shouldn't include any. Spoiler alert, for early-stage token sales, that is what happens to be the case, for now at least. But if you do some research on the internet, you'll find respectable content promoting the use of certain valuation methods. And I've seen other tokenomics professionals apply these methods occasionally as well. So it's worth making the case against those methods in greater detail, hopefully without taking too much of a detour. These valuation methods that you sometimes see pop up are the equation of exchange, discounted cash flow analysis, and price or valuation multiples. To assess each one, we'll need to look at how it works and the problems associated with it. First, the equation of exchange. Now, this is not a valuation method that's in use in traditional finance. It is a theoretical identity that originates in monetary theory. Chris Burniske is credited for proposing this as a valuation method for crypto assets, and I've linked to his original article below. Now, for an expression that looks so disarmingly simple, there's actually a heck of a lot of explanation needed to really detail what's going on here, but we'll get by with a fairly short explanation. This expression says that the total economic value of exchanges or transactions over a period, represented on the right there by the price level times the value measure of those goods, can be rewritten in terms of two other measures: the total amount of money and the average number of times each unit of money would have had to change hands to carry out all those transactions. Essentially, the P term in this expression gives us a foothold that's meant to help us reason about token prices. But this idea caught the attention of the highest profile founder of Ethereum, Vitalik Buterin, who gave it an alternative expression that's a bit more usable in a blockchain context. That expression can be summarized as saying, the average market capitalization of a token over some period can be rewritten as the value of transactions in that period multiplied by the average amount of time that tokens are held before they are traded. I provide a link to his paper below as well. Again, in the interest of time, this is a very high-level explanation of what's going on, but there are still serious and damaging critiques that can be delivered at this level of detail. The first issue that we run into is that in order to use this method to come up with a dollar price of our token, we need one of two things. We either need some independent revelation of USD value in some other market, which is what Burniske does, or we need to assume that the exchange market transactions tell us everything we need to know about the fair dollar value of this asset, which is what Buterin's approach leans into. Now, the big trouble here is that for really new blockchain products, we may not have another independent pricing process to reference. And on the other hand, if we rely on the transactions, they're all swamped by all kinds of speculative demand that tell us nothing about the fair value of the token. These issues seriously compromise the standing of this method to offer a fair value estimate. Unfortunately, there are still more problems to deal with. These arise from the velocity and holding period variables, which are highly variable as well as being asset and time specific. If you enter ranges of these values into your model, this will create value estimates that are really, really wide and so not useful for either fair value estimation nor for benchmarking. And once again, these values are driven by speculative factors, so they can't be used to deliver useful forecasting either. Now, I've heard people counter these arguments by saying that we can use known data about how many tokens are locked or staked to pin down the holding period number. But actually, that still leaves a huge degree of holding period variability for the unlocked tokens that's doing mathematical work in the model. So I don't think that this does much good to improve things. Okay, next up is discounted cash flow analysis, or DCFs. These use a forecast of future cash flow to derive a valuation for the asset. That forecast is created from a model of the underlying business or economic process. And that points to the first challenge with this approach, and that's that we need to add further detailed modeling that goes substantially beyond what's conveyed by our allocation and distribution schedules. Guidance here is also kind of hard to generalize, as that model will necessarily be project specific, showing up the specifics of that business or that economic design. Secondly, uncertainty and variation in the key underlying drivers behind this cash flow forecast, especially for early stage and sometimes pre-operational companies, can end up generating a really unhelpfully wide spread of values once again. And that's a key reason why venture capitalists place limited emphasis on DCFs for early stage valuations. Thirdly, the value accrual and value access mechanics can create added complications and uncertainties that muddy the interpretation of a DCF. Remember, DCF is a cash model, and cash has special value properties that we unthinkingly take for granted to determine a valuation in an ordinary business context. But now, those value stability properties may no longer apply given the value accrual, token conversion, value access mechanics that need to be taken into account. And once again, market speculation swamps any meaning or signal derivable from this measure anyway. Finally, we get to market valuation multiples. They focus on looking at how the market is pricing an asset relative to some measure of underlying economic capacity or activity. This allows you to compare apples with apples, say by looking at different prices that the market pays for the same amount of revenue generating capacity from different companies. Now, in conventional equity analysis, we can calculate these multiples with the benefit of having regulated, standardized, and audited public accounting data. But ironically, in blockchain, the quality of such data is still highly variable and all too often just plain suspect. And even if you were to try and go ahead and construct multiples that reference on-chain data, perhaps, that are harder to fake, there is still too much variation and heterogeneity in those underlying data to create meaningful comparisons with. In short, you don't know if you're really making an apples-to-apples comparison here, as was our intended goal. Traditionally, the way you get around this is to limit your multiples to a selected segment of a specific industry or matching company profile, but these kind of groupings are not yet well-defined or understood in blockchain, and again, there just isn't enough quality, reliable data available to support that analysis yet. And once again, you have that extreme market volatility to contend with as well, which can see multiples fluctuate wildly, limiting their usefulness as a valuation method. So these three valuation approaches that start off with different assumptions to derive a price bottom-up just aren't useful or genuinely insightful in a token sale context. They don't enable investors to make a determination of what their investment is actually worth or to reliably benchmark their investment to comparable projects in the market. Now, if you don't just want to take my word for all this, I'm happy to say that the CFA Institute is making similar observations about those valuation approaches. And if you prefer the opinions of a crypto-native institution, Grayscale aren't promoting those methods in their fundamentals valuation frameworks either. I offer links to the relevant reports below. Now, with all of that said, there is some useful value calculation and exploration that can be supported by a simple token distribution model, and that is often useful. Instead of trying to calculate the price or value inside your model, as those other methods would do, you take the price or value as something that's already given or determined outside of your model, and then explore what the implications of that are. Let's illustrate this on our earlier diagram. The approaches we were just looking at a moment ago treat price as an output. We explained that this doesn't work because the measure is inappropriate or doesn't have the right data to support it. But what we are about to see is that we can still get useful information out of our model by running the price or valuation in as an input. But if we ourselves are choosing the prices to put in, how do we get anything novel coming back out? It all comes down to the fact that the supply of tokens and their attribution to different users and stakeholders emerges from our vesting terms in a way that's really not trivial. And that's why we built the model in the first place, right? To keep track of all that stuff. So we can actually make use of those same non-trivial, non-obvious calculations to make some interesting value explorations. The first thing we can do is estimate a market cap for our token. We do this by choosing a given price and applying it to the number of tokens that our model says are unlocked at a specific point in time. If we assume that these tokens are tradable, this tells us what the market cap is going to be at that specific price. Now, the advantage this method gives us is that we have market cap data easily and widely available. So we can take our market cap number from the model and compare it to those observed in the market and do some reasoning about whether this valuation is likely to be sustainable. That same data also allows us to easily profile the volatility of this metric. And that, in turn, gives helpful context for the stresses and sensitivities of the token price that we may want to run through our model. This approach makes it easy for us to take market volatility as a basic fact and to explore its possible ramifications for the token price. The other advantage that we have is that there is some flexibility over the token base or supply concept that we use to arrive at these calculations. We can restrict the token base to tokens that are matched to specific allocations, excluding those that are held in company control, for example, or taking into account tokens that have been newly locked into smart contracts, along with the times that they are locked up for, or perhaps for operational projects, use machine-learned categories of wallet behavior to define a token supply of interest. This discussion begins to touch on the other way that we can explore value scenarios with the help of these token distribution models. We can borrow principles from conventional dilution analysis and finance to think about how token prices would change if supply increases while the market demand or valuation remains the same. The advantages of this method is that it's familiar from traditional finance and that, once again, we can define a custom token-based concept to meet differing interests or concerns. The final thing to observe about both of these approaches is that they are simple through and through. There is no overreach in what these measurements are presuming to tell you, or complexity to disguise what they are actually doing. They are easy for investors to make sense of in established common sense terms, making it easy for them to think around these value explanations, understanding that they are rough approximations. In that sense, they are great sense checkers. And that's why the most popular valuation metrics quoted in all the investor decks, the initial market cap and the fully diluted valuation, are built from the same fundamental principles. Those definitely do find their way into our model, and we'll look at them and how they are read by investors very soon.